the people, are they able to feel vain about their shows this time around? Sasha, Clarke, and I went to the York Theater to see Jack Hafner's Vanities, which now has music and lyrics by David Kirschenbaum, and is for many women of a certain age, a somewhat defining play when it was originally opened in January 1976 at Playwrights Horizon. The play itself did not age well and is quite dated. I'm giving you Sasha's take first, and then I'll give you a little bit of mine. It starts in 1963, and you have three Texas high school cheerleaders that enter, and we gather that they are best friends and they're about to graduate. And their lives revolve around being very popular, their boyfriends, planning social events to stay popular and to go to college to get their MRS degrees. Anyway, artistic liberties were taken a bit too far, as the likelihood of a large girl being accepted as a cheerleader in the 60s is not realistic at all. And then, well, life changes. Things do not go quite work out as planned or imagined, and the women change or grow more into themselves. And she thought that she was not happy with it at all. She thought this was not the best piece. But I mean, I saw this in college in the 70s when it just came out. So I have a soft spot for this. And it's always interesting to me see what happens to a person or characters in hindsight. And we could see how each had different goals and how they achieved them, and ultimately how it worked out for their ideals versus the reality. And I, you know, Haley Pogchan as Joanna was the quintessential 60s girl. You know, all she cared about was marriage and a husband and kids. Amy Kuhn as Kathy was like the 70s, where she was in college. She organized things with chicken wire and tissues. And then you have Jay Jones as Mary, who was a 90s woman who, you know, didn't care about saving herself for marriage, and college was a waste of time, and she was really into the sexual revolution. So, and this, anyway, what made it work, despite the problems that Sasha mentioned, was that to me, this is basically about friendship and if it can survive through the years and all the changes a person goes through. So I thought the cast voices were lovely, and I enjoyed the music more than Sasha did. So she gave it an unhappy face and I gave it a happy face minus. But you can read more of our review on Facebook page, where we go into much, much more detail. Here we are with Sarah Einspanier's Lunch Bunch with Noah Miller, and let the food fight begin.
If I'm going to throw the first apple, this play reminded me of the plays from the late 60s and 70s, where you had complete silence, and then all of a sudden people would start shouting out little fragments of sentences that made no sense. This play had no rhythm, it had no flow to it, it was very jerky. It stopped, started, stopped, started, and there were no complete sentences. They were just fragments of ideas, and what the playwright was trying to convey was the frustration and anger and emotional upheaval that lawyers go through when they work in a family practice. The difficulties and the emotional upheaval. But then, for some reason, she threw in lunch. There was the lawyers decide to make lunch for themselves, and everybody's responsible for a given day to make lunch. A meal I would have gladly skipped if I had known about that before. I understand it's kind of a metaphor for the frustration and the difficulties with dealing with a taxing career, and also dealing with self-esteem. All of these people, all of the lawyers, seem to be sort of self-hating and trying to build themselves up. But the play was extremely disjointed. It wasn't focused, and it didn't make a whole hell of a lot of sense. I got the gist of it, you know, the self-loathing and the trying to please other people and the difficulties of being a family lawyer. But it's sort of like, why would you be a dentist at a car wash? I didn't see the two mesh, you know, two totally separate subjects that didn't fit together. And I just thought the whole play was a disjointed mess, and I was very frustrated with it. And I couldn't understand why David Greenspan was there. At some point, the lights dimmed and he gave this absolutely pointless gibberish about being in a prehistoric time. And I'm sure it was all terribly Kafkaesque and metaphorical, but you know, sometimes you have to be more like Steinbeck. Say what the hell you mean to say and say it straight and forward. This is my unhappy face for this. Very unhappy and confused.
My turn now, jeepers. I strongly disagree with you so much. I thought this was brilliant and hilarious and touching, and the cast was amazing. And there have been countless workplace plays and trying to prove yourself plays, but this was a completely different take on these things. And they were not family lawyers. They were public defenders. So they're stuck with these cases, these impossible cases, with this horrible judge who loves separating families from their children. I mean, they are overloaded with cases, given no support. There's an evil judge always separating families and a kinder judge who cares. When you have a stressful job, it's important to have an outlet that keeps you sane and gives you something to look forward to. So they formed this lunch bunch, and it wasn't fragmented at all. They were like, Monday, I prepared beans and kale salad. Tuesday, I prepared this. Wednesday, each of them has a day where they prepare a gourmet sandwich of some or meal of some sort. And Jacob was sort of the leader of them all. He's been there for 10 years, for God's sakes. He has low expectation when it comes to humanity and its system. He's completely fed up with his job that he has managed to perform for 10 years. But to keep himself from the breaking point, he has one joy in life, one place where he can feel in control, and that is food. So he takes the lunch bunch very seriously, brilliantly played by Ugo Chukwa. Greg tries to keep everything in perspective by reading douchey books and making the same thing every time because he can't go wrong with beans, rice, kale, and tofu. Hannah is great at finessing the system and following recipes. Paul thumbs up the lunchbox by going off to Paris, but promised to return with many cheeses. Mitra is new there and has brought her own fancy lunch, so she would make the perfect replacement for Tal. But then Tuttle, who is rather hyper and subject to night terrors, she temporarily drops out of the group because she is going on the Whole30 diet to find out whatever has been giving her occasional guests and your constant feelings of worthlessness. This forces them to include the new, not very confident Nicole, who is at a loss how to make gourmet sandwiches, but desperately wants to fit in and be included. But nobody can be as bad as David, that's David Greenspan, who is just referred to in a horrified whisper of pretzels. Yes, there were unexplained terms dropped that I had to look up, but the acting was so monumental that I could get the gist of what they meant. I may not understand Yiddish or foreign movies, but without reading the subtitles, you can tell emotionally what is going on and even laugh. So I made a glossary, in the review, I made a glossary of what everything was. Lunch Bunch is one satisfying meal, and I give this a major, major happy face.
Parade has a book by Alfred Urey, music and lyrics by Jason Robert Brown, and directed by Michael Arden. It's the story of Leo Frank, a true story of a white Jewish man from Brooklyn who was tried in Georgia in 1913 for the murder of 13-year-old Mary Fagan, a worker in the pencil factory that he was the manager of. He does not fit in at all down south. He's also not a sympathetic figure. He's very kind of contemptuous of all the people around him. His wife, who's a Southern Jewish lady, fits in quite well, but he's really like condescending to her and treats her sort of like Torvald treats Nora in Doll's House.
Torvald in Doll's House treats Nora a little bit more tenderly. He doesn't seem very tender towards her. I mean, there was a real love story there. Here, you're wondering why she fell for him and all that. He's just so prickly.
Yeah, you don't see what she saw in him at all.
Yeah.
But they do, he does sort of, when he's more vulnerable, after the trial and being convicted, he actually does come to finally accept that his wife is a really smart woman.
It's, you know what it's like? It's like the baker in Into the Woods, where it's like, no, I'm going to the woods by myself. No, you don't have to help me. Go back to the bakery shop. I'm going to take care of everything. But it's the wife that actually does everything and saves the day. So in a way, it was a sort of the same kind of thing here. But this is, you know, this is a real story. I mean, these might be spoiler alerts, but you could probably, yeah, if you Googled it beforehand, you would probably know the whole story. But this is told with Jason Robert Brown music, which is always so lush and swelling. And I mean, the way he orchestrates things is just, his music just always drives you to tears and makes your heart swell. So this was just beautifully told. And Michaela Diamond as Lucille Frank, and Ben Platt as Leo Frank, they were just so good. And it had such an amazing supporting cast. You know, you've got Howard McGillin in it and Manuela Feliciano in these small but mighty parts. J. Armstrong Johnson, you know, with his great voice. And how they liken it with the Civil War, you know, because the Civil War really just happened. It just shows that it wasn't just down south that they were prejudiced against the Black people. They were also against the Jewish people, too. And a lot of times people don't realize that basically white supremacists are just against everybody who isn't white.
Well, especially at that time.
Yeah.
It's also, this is one of the few shows where I really appreciated the projections, because they showed the real people.
Yes.
And it really gave, you know, another dimension to this show. And it felt like it was necessary.
Yeah.
Most of the time, it's just kind of like, what's all this busyness with photos?
No. This was good. This was really almost like a musical documentary, mm-hmm, even though it was sort of fictionalized and heightened because it's a musical. And I got to tell you, I saw the original and I did not like it. I hated it, and which really upset me because, you know, it was a Jewish story and historical and all that. But this time around, they fixed it. They made it. I mean, the ending, which was to me, when I saw it, ridiculous. Here it was moving and sad and just like, whoa. And you really got the full emotion out of it. So I can't strongly recommend this show enough. And the voices are just so gorgeous. So I'm giving this like a major, major happy face.
It's another must-see.
Yes.
Happy face too, of course.
This is Jake Goldblath's review. Joe Testino, bringer of doom, in this play, the events of the plot concern Latte, who entertains dinner for her boyfriend Demetrius, and mother Esme, who brings her own fiance Clancy. The setup for the play has Lottie vowing for revenge against her mother and potential stepfather, and to do so, she enlists the support of an insult comedian who is not her real boyfriend. Two themes in the play is great comedy and the thematic undercurrent of death. Ringer of Doom promises insult comedy and uses its missed swings for awkward humor. The actress and director have just nailed their timing, and surprising slapstick facial expressions scoop and squeeze words like Shakespeare or Frank Sinatra. Suddenly, jokes like, just shoot me, started to land harder, with more surprises and emotional heft as the play progresses. He just loved this play, two pieces, and gives it a major happy face plus. And there's way more on Facebook.
Television, written and directed by Cameron Darwin Bassett, is set in 1959 in a small town in Colorado when the local television station loses its network affiliate. The company decides to go with local programming, and pretty much everybody in town gets involved. The whole Fitzwater family, the son who's going to college writes scripts, the mother eventually wants to do a cooking show, her sister is the star of the son's scripts, and later the father even gets a chance to appear on TV. This station really want to explore the possibilities of local programming, or is it just a stopgap until they could do better? I thought it was really interesting to try to see how being on television changes these very remarkably ordinary people into something a bit stranger. I thought it was clever, could have been a little shorter, but I really liked it. I gave it a half.
The head of the television, Harris, you know, the local thing, even gets his budget director, Bobby, involved in the acting and clippings of the show that Billy wrote. And naturally, I couldn't help but think of public access, which is what we're on, YouTube, which we're on, and the progressions built up to the TikTok of today with influencers and cooking shows. And I enjoyed how much Harris took an impossible crisis and came up with the solution to keep his television franchise going. He was able to hit every curveball thrown his way and turn it into a success. He had that American don't give up and can-do spirit, even if it was exploitative at times. The only thing, I did have a little trouble with some of the characters' behaviors and motivation. I mean, the dad was just so dismissive of his wife and son that I couldn't see how they could put up with his surliness. And you know, the sister who was a star seemed like such a diva, and some of her actions made no sense to me at all. And Patty Fitzwater was a perfect housewife of the day. And Billy Fitzwater was a bit of an enigma, going off to study psychology in college while at the same time seeming to have this remarkable talent for writing. And what did he really think of his family? And the likable postman cared deeply about his job until television ruined him. And it was nice that the budget director was this delightful sidekick with a conscience. And I really liked the grittiness that Cameron Darwin Bassett, who wrote this and directed this, had in his previous plays of the Disney studio. And now he's lifting the curtain on early television. So I give this a happy face minus. And we got Jake Goldbas back on the show, and his review will be on Facebook. And he gave it a happy face too. So you got three people who like this show. This is Sasha Clarke's review. Mine's going to be on Facebook. And we both saw Urban Stage presenting a lovely compact production of Ellen Abrams' Eleanor and Alice, a compelling version of the history of this storied family. We encounter the woman at key points in their lives from 1904 to the 60s, the often mean-spirited Alice doing her best to shock and embarrass her older cousin publicly and privately and succeeding. Alice is devoted to her brother, who also runs for president and other political offices. And that's something neither one of us knew about. And the Roosevelts find themselves on different ends of the political spectrum. The action concentrates on Eleanor's life doing good and offering her services towards racial equality after Franklin's death, while Alice remains throughout a spoiled brat who sees no purpose in donating her services in any way. All Alice cares about is getting back in the White House and lording it all over everybody, while Eleanor, all she cares about is helping the country. The Ellen Abrams material was well-researched and laid out, and the Jamie Terrazino and Madeline Burrow set design was well thought out and provided a setting, along with the Gail Cooper Heck costumes of period and place in a very small area. Both women turned in good performances, but to Sasha's mind, Trezana Beverly playing Eleanor was simply too old compared to Mary Bacon, Alice, who passes for a younger woman at the beginning of the show and then acted older as she aged. Overall, it is a tight and interesting vantage point from the inside. Good use was made of the time before the show started and between the scenes for the music and some slides to set the stage and let us know the current events of the day, from suffrage and prohibition through to Martin Luther King. And we got this great talk back afterwards with Harold Holzer, author, lecturer, and TV commentator. He serves as director of Hunter College's Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute, and he spoke with novelist and journalist Kevin Baker about various historical details, including the fact that Franklin and Eleanor and their many children lived with Franklin's mother in a brownstone on the Upper East Side. It was very enjoyable, and they were able to take some questions from the audience as well. But she's giving it a mixed face because she had problems with it. I will, in my review later on, will be giving it a happy face minus, although it was Ellen Abrams' birthday that day and it was still Passover and they had cake and champagne that I could not indulge in. And it was very difficult for me because I had to still eat my review on the Facebook page. And really, if you like historical drama, this is the play to see. And now I've got such a treat for you. You might know him from America's Got Talent, Tape Face. He's also on YouTube. I mean, if you're like one in the morning and depressed, go to YouTube, punch in Tape Face. You'll be hysterical laughing. Well, you can see him live. He's going to be at the Palladium on April 22nd tonight. So go see him. And I got a chance to talk to him and see his act. And I love this guy. And Benjamin Laufer is going to go check him out and get tickled like I did. Hello, here we are with a spokesman for Tape Man, and your name is?
My name is Sam Wills, otherwise known as Tape Face.
Oh, Tape Face. Oh, I'm in a Marvel universe. So speaking of masks and Marvels, how did you come up with this idea? Did your mom tell you to shut up too many times?
I think that's happened to a lot of families. I know I used to do another show, a completely different show where I talked a lot of stand-up comedy, a lot of improvisation, and I decided to challenge myself one day and come up with a silent character. So my friend sort of teased me a bit about this idea of me doing a silent clown. And originally when I performed, I didn't have tape at all, and I went to a comedy club and I did a set, and I lasted about 15 seconds before I ruined it by talking. So I came back the next night and a friend of mine backstage said to me, the only way you could do a silent comedy character is if you gaffer tape your mouth shut. And that's how it came about, and ironically the idea stuck.
And silence is golden in your case.
And silence is absolutely golden.
So what are you going to, which are your YouTube creations, or do you have new ones for the Palladium on April 22nd?
There's quite a lot of content that hasn't been on YouTube. I try and keep a lot of stuff off YouTube because I'm a big fan of live performance. So that way when people come along, they're going to see lots of different things that they've not seen on TV.
Like what?
Like what? Things that happen to me, I'm going to bring John Lennon back to life. I'm going to have a fight with Darth Vader, and there's going to be a lot of balloons.
And will your puppet persona be there?
Puppet Face will be helping out on stage, absolutely. He keeps things clean and sorted.
How about those hot mittens that you got?
The hot mittens, those are, they are a hot item, those hot mittens. Everyone wants a set of mittens.
Well, they're such good singers.
They are, absolutely. It's the pun, endless love, endless glove.
Oh my God, I love puns, and I didn't even pick up on that one. But I did get the Women in Red one.
Yes, it's all good. It's a good fun sketch, that. Enjoy that.
And if anyone wants to laugh at 1 in the morning, they should check you on YouTube, which I did. And I'm like, I couldn't stop laughing. And my kid's like, what are you laughing at? I'm like, you wouldn't get it because you're no fun.
Yeah, you can easily go down a YouTube hole watching a whole lot of weird stuff.
And you're the element of weird. You say...
Weird, that's our motto, is stay weird. So stay weird, everyone.
Well, congrats. I'm glad you came up with this acting, that you went to America's Got Talent. What made you go to America's Got Talent?
I'd been touring around the UK, and I'd already done a lot of touring through the UK and through Europe, and I decided I want to come over here to America to crack the comedy market over here, and I realized that the comedy scene over here is huge, it's monstrous, so it would have taken me about 10 years to rise through the ranks of comedy, whereas going on a show like America's Got Talent gives me that exposure straight away. So it boomed, and then we were able to take the show to a lot bigger places faster.
I like a person who starts at the top.
You can't go wrong with that.
It's not where you start, where you finish. No, it's where you start on the top.
Yeah, start at the top and try and stay up there.
Well, thank you very much.
No problems. Thank you very much.
Ever since I met him, I'd ask you if you wanted to dance. For a little romance, here I have a chance. I have never seen a dress you wear, all the highlights in your hair. Ha ha.
Closing on April 23rd, and again, reviews will be on the Facebook page, and there's a lot of closed reviews on the Facebook page that fell through the cracks. Agatha Christie's The Stranger is going to be at the Players Theater, and it's part of the Literally Alive people, but the grown-up version. And J2 Spotlight is back with their old musicals. They're doing Women of the Year until April 23rd. That was that Lauren Bacall musical. And before Some Like It Hot, there was Sugar. And that's going on from April 27th to May 7th. And one of my favorite musicals, The Goodbye Girl, that was with Martin Short and Bernadette Peters, May 11th through 21st. You're living on an Elliot Garfield, Grant. And closing April 30th at the Public Theater is Susan Laurie Park's play, which has come back, called Plays for the Plague Year. And there's so much Broadway shows opening up right now that, you know, through all of summer we'll be talking Broadway shows. So see you May 6th. Have a wonderful summer, spring, whatever.